Now let's get back to the real meat of the subject, which is I believe this is still part of this review. I was trying to say, I try to emphasize that bottom up mathematics is a natural language processing, because this is, you know, however you want to define it. Meta mathematics is LLM. And top-down mathematics, this intuition-guided thing, at the end of the day, is image processing. I like this image processing idea, which is, you know, any mathematics, any mathematical data, platonic data, if you wish, at some level is an image. You can pixelate it. I like this image analogy because the great David Mumford, who is also a Fields Medalist, even back in the 90s, after he got the Fields Medal, he stopped everything. He got the Fields Medal for doing topology in K-theory, if I remember, it's algebraic topology. And then he switched fields completely, dropped mathematics altogether, and started working on computer vision. And now that I've read more of his recollections, he blogs as well. He's a very excellent blogger like Terry Tao. So David Mumford, he said, the reason he got into this computer vision thing was, I think he was really having early visions of how AI can help with research, because he was trying to imagine the human mind being an image processing machine. What does a mathematician actually see? The mathematician is beginning to have mental images of formulae. There is this transformation process from what you see as abstraction, as mathematics, into a mentally constructed image. That's why he was so interested in vision. And that image in the mind is somehow... Well, in today's language, this will be the latent representation of your data.
You know Hadamard, how he had a book on how mathematicians think?
Oh, I heard of that. I have not read that. That's kind of interesting. Is that the same Hadamard as the Hadamard Delavaye-Poussin Hadamard? Oh, that's interesting. Oh, cool guy.
Yeah. And and I'm wondering if he did a historical analysis for Euler, because Euler was blind for half his life or something like that. Large portion of his life. So I'm wondering if Euler still used mental imagery to formulate or solve his problems, or if he had to then abstract to something else.
Absolutely. It's quite imagined. I had a student once in Oxford a few years ago now. She was quite remarkable because she's completely blind. I think she was blind from an early age. So she sat through my lessons without being able to see anything. She had to picture what I was saying and then digest it all in her head and do all of the mental calculations in her head.
Interesting.
So I was wondering, what was she actually doing? And she did fairly well in her final exams with being completely, she needed somebody obviously to translate whatever she's had to dictate to someone in, so it was quite remarkable. That I got to know the student, but anyhow, but my image processing is this kind of thing. Is now that I read Mumford, I'm beginning to think why I was beginning to think that all of mathematics is all of top down, all pattern recognition is an image processing problem.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, this, I guess there is this old debate, and this involved all the greats like Atiyah and Digraph and Hitchin and Witten, all these people. Is physics, or is theoretical physics, or is mathematics inherently, is nature algebraic, or is it geometric?
Interesting.
So this top-down mathematics, this is a debate. Newton was clearly geometrical. He had such a distaste and disdain for algebra because it's meaningless symbols to him. He made some comment about algebra is this, I can't remember the original quote, but he would say something, it's a very disgusting thing that you had to resort to this meaningless symbols. He was very, very pictorial. His proof of what we now call the Gauss theorem about integration over spheres, this was just some about, you know, a gravitational body exerting a force on an external object. Gauss would just surround this by and then use his Gauss's law. But Newton actually integrated piece by piece and used all his intricate pieces together in a diagram and got the same answer. It's the kind of horror show you would never do, because Gauss's theorem is just one line. You just do this integral. But Newton actually had to piece together. So Newton was definitely visual. Roger Penrose is definitely visual. Penrose, my last conversation with him, he said, he almost said, I think, I'm putting words in his mouth, but I believe he says something like, if it's not intuitive and if it's not geometrical, he doesn't even accept that as a proof. And I think Conway was like that as well. This is one of the reasons why Conway never really accepted Richard Borchardt's proof of the moonshine conjectures, because Borchardt used this very strange vertex operator algebra. I think you had a conversation with Ed Frankel about this.
And Borchardt's, actually.
And Borchardt's, yeah, exactly. But the Borchardt's, he borrowed this piece of completely crazy stuff, vertex operator algebras, and had this beautiful structure. It's obviously awesome and brilliant. It got him the Fields Medal. And he was able to use that to prove the moonshine conjecture from Kai. And Conway, to my knowledge, the previous director of the IS, a good friend.
Robert Dykgraff?
The one before the... Goddard. Peter Goddard. Peter Goddard knew Conway very well, and he was telling me that Conway never really deep down accepted this proof of Borchardt because he's not visual. Conway is this very playful guy, as you can imagine. He wanted everything to be pictorial. He wanted to see his lattices. So in a way, this diagram puts geometry in this direction and puts algebra in this direction.
Well, how is Conway visualizing the monster group?
Maybe in terms of the Leech lattice. He had picture of the Leech lattice. To him, the monster group is some extension of automorphism of the Leech lattice. Which, right. I guess, in the way, that's how he and Gries and Riba originally came up with the monster. It wasn't by very hardcore this whole funny business of classifying simple groups that it. He really intuited it in a way. He got this group out by doing norm two lattices, and he was able to see the symmetry, the group of symmetries of this lattice, and that's a remarkable thing. It's just unfortunate that whole generation of people are that generation of this. Lattice, early computer algebra, finite group people are slowly dying out. You know, Conway is dead, Norton is dead, and my own dear friend John Mackay, who started Moonshine, passed away. I wrote his obituary because I was his last close collaborator. He actually became a grandfather figure to me. He became, you know, he saw my kids grow up.
Interesting.
And Mackay would tell me the stories about how he was interacting with Conway and how all of that people, how Borchardt's. And Mackay is also, here's another crazy, that's another whole conversation about what is this bizarre intuition that Mackay had. If there's anybody in the later part of the 20th century who had a almost Ramanujan-like intuition, would be John Mackay. In a way, he's an unsung hero, because he would just look at lists of numbers or look at pictures and graphs and see, but this field is related to this. And that is very much like this. He's AI before AI.
Even physicists?
I think that's a whole different conversation. We're going to have to do part 3 and 4. This is, okay, I get very emotional when I talk about John, because he's like he's a very much like a father figure to me.
Well, the next time I'm in Oxford, we should have a part 3 and 4.
We have a part 3 conversation just talking about moonshine conjectures. In the from the perspective, Mackay, I know you certainly, and he pronounced his name Mackay, not Mackay, even though it's written down as Mackay. He insisted on being called John Mackay. I know you chatted with Franco, and you chatted with Borchardt on moonshine and that stuff. But it's unfortunate that he passed away before you started all this thing. Mm-hmm. He passed in 2022, because he had a very interesting knowledge of that world of moonshine and stuff. But anyhow,
have you heard of stone duality?
Stone?
Yeah, stone duality or a stone type duality?
No, not at all. What is that?
So it's a duality between topology and then Boolean algebras, which some people see as an analogy or an equivalence between geometry and then syntax, or something more algebraic.
Oh, interesting. Oh, I'll have to look into that. Thanks for pointing out. I didn't know. Is this like the stone of the stone Weierstrass theorem stone?
I believe so. You got them all correct, yeah.
I don't know. Okay, I just didn't know there was this stone. This is called the stone correspondence? Or?
Yeah, or stone duality, yeah.
Duality. Oh, I would love to see it. Sorry, I just bumped in my... I'd love to see that. Oh, interesting. Very interesting. Anyhow, so back to our current story. So in 2022, ChatGPT actually, as you know, pertinent to this conversation, ChatGPT passed the Turing test, which I'm very surprised it was not on every single newspaper headline. I don't know why this wasn't emphasized either. We can't really... Turing test was a big thing. I think that the fact that ChatGPT passed the Turing test just simply showed that you don't need reasoning or understanding to have intelligent conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it says a lot about humans. It says more. ChatGPT passing the Turing test says more about humans than it says about AI thinking. Mm-hmm. We give too much credit, but to what meaningful conversations are. But this, sort of as a response to that, we organized a conference in Cambridge with loads and loads of people, and you can probably recognize some of the names, Buzzard and Birch. We tried to formulate something that's more stringent than a Turing test for AI guided discovery. And so I reported this with my friend Bert of as a Nature correspondence. And this is, again, I can't remember whether I talked about this in our... Did I talk about the Birch test?
Yes, the Birch test plus plus, or the Turing test plus plus was the Birch test?
Yeah, it's the Birch test, yeah.
Last time. So we'll put a link on screen for the last conversation in case you're just tuning in and you're wondering. Oh, it was a wonderful conversation. And I believe we talked about, let's see, the Birch test, bottom up, top down, meta mathematics, and even classifications of CY manifolds, and then this database construction.
Right. Okay, so I can pass with the B. So this is AI plus N for the Birch test. So I'm very good at digressing. Sometimes I digress so much that I don't even remember what I'm digressing on anymore. But the point is, this is clear signs of ADHD, but I've never had it.
As you mentioned, in the, speaking about these shower thoughts or the margins, the digressions are sometimes more meaty than the meat.
Often, yeah.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.